Okay, thank you. So first I want to thank the organizer for giving me the opportunity to give this talk and also for the nice day. And I want also to thank Pierre Navarro and Mathieu Effelé and Edwin Chacon-Golcher for help in this project. So this work is a part of my work at IPP in Garching. And so I had also the opportunity to use big computers to do the simulation. So this work is done with a joint work with Bedros Afeyan, so with the physicist of Kinewaves. So Fernando Casas, which is a specialist on time splitting scheme, Nicolas Crozet, which is close, and Eric Zonendrucker, which are close collaborators, Adela Dodi also, and Erwan Faou from Rennes. So first I will give a short introduction about Kinewaves. So Kinewaves are asymptotic states in Vlasov plasma. So they have different characteristics. One is that they are non-stationary, it's a non-linear process, and they are also self-organized. This means maybe that there is an autoconsistent field. Yeah. So here we want to make a study when we change the amplitude of the drive. In fact, we have a ponderative force which can be seen as an applied field, and so we want to change the amplitude of the drive and see also the duration of the drive. So we will just see the model. The model is simply the Vlasov-Poisson equation, so in 1D times 1D, so it's a simple equation. And we have so an applied field here. So this is here. So okay. And so we can change the amplitude of the drive, which is here I A D R, and also the time of when we do the apply field. And for initial condition, we just take Maxwellian. And so if we wouldn't add this ponderative force, there will be just a Maxwellian, which says Maxwellian, it's equilibrium. But with this ponderative force, this gives a non-linear feature, which are difficult to capture. Okay. So what's now the plan of the talk? So first, I will present some first results that we had 2 years ago in the SEMRAX 2012 project. We have begun to work on the Kinewaves. Then I will present two in the main ingredients that are used for dealing with numerics, so non-uniform cubic splines and high-order splitting. And then we will present some numerical results. First, just L2 norms, the rho harmonics, and which is just the first Fourier mode of rho, which is the integral of f. And then we will also give some begin of physical results. That is, we want to characterize when we have Kinewaves or when we have not Kinewaves. Okay. So this is the results that we obtained in the SEMRAX 2012. So one thing is to plot so the distribution function, but we remove the Maxwellian, so we just look at the delta F distribution function. And in fact, this distribution function is really localized, so in velocity. So in the v-axis, this is the velocity, but it's just a part of the domain. Okay. So maybe this is 0.3 and 2.3 in a velocity. So and the whole range is -6, 6. So, but there is this Maxwellian, so we cannot just take the small domain, but we have to take the whole domain, but so we want to, so here it is done on a uniform grid, but we have used many points, so, and done the computation on CPU and also on GPU to accelerate the results. Okay. So this is for the canonical drive. So this is ADR is equal to 0.2 and T, the duration of the drive is 100. So we will also here consider so some weak drive where ADR is very smaller. And when ADR is very smaller, this region in velocity is even smaller. Okay. So here it will be difficult to use just a uniform mesh. So we should use here some adaptive or refined mesh where there is this feature in velocity. Okay. So how to change the uniform grid? Okay. So there are two. There are different possibilities. So we can go to non-uniform grids. We can go to full adaptative. So there is a different work that I've done on this topic. But one thing is that we have to find something that is efficient. And sometimes with adaptive methods, it's difficult to have efficiency. And also, I would like to underline that we should nowadays there is a lot of Lazov solvers and so on. And I like to insist that we should give the efficiency of the implementation. And this is usually done for peak codes. So what a number of points that are advected per second or per microsecond, this is done. But for Vlasov-based solver, it's not so usual to do it. So I will just recall some simple things about the efficiency of the schemes. So maybe this will good habits in the future papers. okay. So one way to measure the efficiency, the CIS is down by. So it is Edwin Chacon-Golchers. We told me this. So one way to measure the efficiency is to see how many points are advected. So, for example, in double precision. So here it's in 1D because here we will do a splitting. So per microsecond and per processor. So this gives generally a good way to see how the code performs. This is some constant. We can have some feeling about when we give this number, we know a little what's on. Okay. And this is done for PIX codes. For very old paper, we see this measure in physics paper. But for grid points, Vlasov, it's not so usual. So maybe it would be nice also to compare with this PIX code. Okay, so the formula is very simple. So here, of course, here it's adapted to a split schemes. Of course, if it's not split schemes, we have to change a little, but At least we can compare here four splitting schemes how this performs. So here also we have the number of points in X, in V, the time step, and the final time. And also here we have to use the substeps per time step. So for example, if you use the classical strong splitting, we make delta t over 2, delta t in this direction, and then delta t over 2 in the other direction. So we have 2 or 3, because sometimes we can combine the last time step of advection of one advection with the previous of the next iteration. And also, so we have to give the time in second and the number of processor. And so the formula is very simple. And so you can compute this, and this gives a number. And this number characterizes a little how the scheme is well implemented. Okay. So you will see the results. On, for example, we can ask what's on about GPU, what's about using OpenMP, MPI, and so on, how this behave, okay? This is maybe better than just doing strong scaling, weak scaling. This gives better this feature. Okay, so you will see now the results. Okay, so this above is the results on a different size. So you see when you use a sequential optimized code, you have an efficiency of 29%. On GPU, it's more. And then when you move to bigger grids, so you get less performance. And on GPU, you obtain a very big performance. Okay. So this is some measures we have done on our code. It's maybe not the best optimized code, but it gives a measure. Okay. So here, now in the code that we use in Celalib, but on many processors, and so we have an efficiency which is very reduced. It's only about 4. But okay, it's more general and. It's not only on one processor. Okay, so this gives just an indication to measure. Okay, this gives a measure. We have not tried to really optimize things, but this gives a measure. Okay. So here we use grids until this number of points, and generally 2,056 processors, but we can go up to 2,000 processors. And we use a mixed parallelization, MPI and OpenMP. In fact, with API, it's good, but when we add OpenMP, it's a little better, but it depends on the case. So of course, there is still room for improvements. But the first step is to measure what is the results. Okay, then you can improve. But okay, so what is the first conclusion is that when a GPU, so is very good, but one GPU, if you use 100 processors or more, then GPU is no more competitive. Okay. Of course, then we can use multiple GPU. Multiple GPU is more complex, and so we have to deal with different things. Okay, so then we can also compare with PIC. And so Sever gave me the picture about PIC. And so here, the efficiency is about 13, okay? And this is just in one step. So we use just one step to do, here in this semi-Lagrangian splitting, we use several steps. Okay. So this 13 has to be compared a bit about, 10 maybe for the size here, or we had to divide by 2 or 3. Okay. So this gives a first measure about how the code behaves. Okay. Then, of course, this is don't link to how what is the error you made. On PIC codes, maybe you have an error that is bigger, or but this gives at least what's on about the operation. Also, what we have learned last time is that peak code go until 2040 points. So this is we have seen in the talk of Stéphane Colombouis. So with 3D Vlasov Poisson solver, I think this is maybe there is more, but okay. So this gives a little our its case. Okay, so now I will speak about the non-uniform cubic splines. So we have to use here non-uniformity because we want to simulate a very small region in velocity. So we have to adapt the schemes that we use, which are generally on uniform grids. So in a semi-Lagrangian scheme, it's not so easy to do it. One way to do it is to use a discontinuous Galerkin scheme or something like this, but in general, with interpolation, we can have some problems, and so it's there are not so many methods that work for non-uniform mesh. So the first thing is how to generate non-uniform mesh. So there are several possibilities. Here we want to do something very simple. That is, we want to use delta V coarse and a delta V fine. And so we will have So we will have a fine region and a coarser region, okay? Like it is written here in the picture. So we'll just give some example. So here we fix the first velocity where there is the fine region and the last velocity where is the fine region. So this is the parameter, the input parameters. And with this, and we have to also to fix the ratio between the delta V coarse and delta V fine. And so this thing we fix to 32. And then with this, the program behaves good and gives the fine mesh. Okay. And we fix the total number of points. The total number of points is the points inside the mesh and outside the mesh. So that it's really parameterized by the total number of points. Generally, what we do also is to do, okay, we do a fine region and then with n points, and then, but we can add some points, so we are not sure really about how many points that are used, so because it can be added with the two-grid method. So here we wanted really to fix at first the number of points, then where we want to refine, and then what is the ratio. Okay, so everything is parametered this way. It's a choice. Okay, so what we see is that for the canonical drive, okay, so we have to take this, but for the weak drive, so the box is really small, and so we will have really, it's really interesting here to use non-uniform mesh. Okay. Then there is a question about is it good to do just one uniform mesh fine and then really big coarse mesh, or is it good to refine a little? So this we don't know. We have used this. It's easier, but maybe it's better to do some smoothness between the two meshes. This we don't know if it's... What we have remarked is that if the factor is too big and the mesh is too the number total number of points is too small, then we have some problems, of course. But if we take enough points, then with this factor it seems to be enough. Then it's not necessary to get a bigger factor, because then the number of points outside the fine mesh is negligible between the other. So maybe this factor is enough and is good. Okay. Okay, so now we have to explain a little how it works, the non-uniform splines. So if you use, so we can use just the non-uniform lines with the interpolation, but this doesn't work very well because this scheme is not conservative. It doesn't conserve the mass. So we have to adapt a little to have uniform, to have a mass conservative scheme. So we use simply the conservative form. One other feature is that we have to put the unknowns on the middle of the cells. We cannot put it at the same points that and in the case of the advective scheme, because otherwise the mesh is no more this simple mesh. And how it works, so there is two things. So we will use a cubic spline interpolation for the primitive, so the classical that is used for the advective, so just the interpolation. And to do so we have to remove and add a total mass to div with a primitive that is periodic. Otherwise, we have problem with the boundary conditions. So. And then in the X direction, so here we just use uniform mesh. So for example, our favorite Lagrange interpolation of degree 70. Okay, so this finished the part of the space phase space discretization. Now we go to the time discretization. So one favorite scheme is to use the classical strang splitting, so which is second order. In almost every paper on Vlasov simulation, Vlasov-Poisson simulation, this scheme is used. Okay, so it's very favorite. So here it's recalled. So we solve a constant transport equation in x direction, then in v direction, and then again in x direction. Okay. So there are generalization of these schemes which are high order. And so to see this, so we first see that here, so the splitting we can parameterize it by this. So S is equal to 3 because here we have 3 substeps. Okay. Sigma init is can be equal to 1 or 0. Here is equal to 1 because we begin with X. If it would be 0, it would begin with V. And then there is just the list of the coefficients. Okay, so 1 half, 1 and 1 half. So with this, we can deal with we can generalize this. Okay, so a generalization so that we have found, which is a six-order scheme. So I will later explain how this scheme is derived. So is the following. So it's just a generalization of this. When we look at this parametrization. So the six-order scheme is just this. So we take S equal to 11. Okay, we take A1, A2, and A6, so until A11, and sigma init is equal to 0. Okay. So even if you don't understand nothing about how this scheme is derived, you can just put this in your code, and then you see that it works very, very well. This is a six-order scheme. Okay. So it's a very simple scheme. Okay. So now I will explain a little how this scheme is derived. So one thing is to see that the A, so that's particular, that the coefficients depend on delta T. Okay. So that's strange. Generally, we don't use a coefficient which itself depends on delta T. So but with this way, in fact, we can improve a lot the scheme and go to higher order. Okay. So this is due to Fernando Casas. So he has provided the coefficients, and that we have just seen that it works. Okay. So now I will explain a little What is the history of the time splitting? So we have already seen the trunk scheme. So one way to do higher order, generally what is done is to use the classical triple jump. So this is a combination of trunk splitting with some coefficient 1/2 over 2 to the power 1/3, something like this. And so we can go to fourth order. And but the problem of such scheme is that so it's easy to implement, but the law is also easy. So but this down this this problem is that we do this zigzag, a lot of zigzags, and so there are coefficients that are negative, and we have a lot of steps, so it's not so good. Because we have to do a lot of a lot of substeps, and so this is not so efficient. Okay, and then in 2002, so there is a Blanes, so it's not Blanes, it's Blanes, and Moon, which have done because it's Spanish, which have used optimized coefficients, and so this works better. Okay. So to see a review, you can see there is a paper of Yaman Guklu about this, and everything is well explained, what are the different time schemes that are used. And so there is some feature, so again, strung is popular. So higher order splitting is not used, so why? In fact, it can be used, but in fact, we have to have enough refined solution in a phase space. So if it's good result in phase space, we have high order in phase space, then we will see the time error. So then we can improve the strung splitting. Okay. And but for that to work, we have also to find some solutions that reduce the number of stages. We have not to use many number of stages, and also the size of the negative coefficient should be small. So this is really important. And when we see at the coefficients, you see here that the coefficients are not so negative. There is a 6 which is negative, but it's not so bad. Okay. Yes. So in fact, here it is mixed, so it's explained here. So you see A1 is so the steps in X, A2 is the steps in V, so we go X, V, X. So here we have 11 steps, so we have about 6 steps in X and 5 steps in X, or the contrary. Okay. Instead of 2 steps in X and 1 step in V. And also, what is a remark, here we begin with V, okay? So it's not reversible, okay? If we begin with X, we cannot use these coefficients. We have to use other coefficients, okay? So now I will try to explain a little about how these coefficients are derived, okay? So we had done some work before, but just doing développement limité. And we have checked that for until fourth order, we are like the Blaine and Moon coefficients. But if we want to go and in this way, we have done a lot of pages, maybe 40 pages of computations and with Maple. But if we understand a little more in the abstract sense, so this really helps, of course. But so this is the work of Erwan Fahou, so which likes this Hamiltonian structure and so on. And this really helps. Yeah. But it's more complicated. We have to understand the abstract situation. So I will try to explain a little. So we define the Hamiltonian, which is two parts. In fact, the two parts will correspond to the the advection in X and the advection in V. And so we can rewrite the Vlasov-Poisson equation in this way with the Poisson bracket. And in fact, this is not even enough. So this, in fact, here we deal with the functionals. Okay, we do not deal only with the derivative about x and v position, but we deal also with the derivative about functionals. We can see this because this is because maybe the electric field depends itself on the function f. Okay. So anyway, you can check. So I don't know how this has been done, but you can check. So this is easy to check because you can do derivatives of Fréchet about. It's the same way. In fact, it's just you have to check it. And so you can see that this equation can be rewritten as a evolution equation like this. Okay. And then you can use the exponential, in fact. So that's the trick, okay? But we have to define this this Poisson bracket, which is... okay, so it's... of course, people which do Hamiltonian, they know this thing by heart, but I don't. Okay. And but in this way, in fact, so we can compute so the different brackets with T and U and see how it simplifies and so on, and what are the relations, okay? And so what we can remark is that for Vlasov-Poisson equation, so in 1D, this is not true in a more general situation, we have this relation TUU is equal to 2U, okay? So this will simplify a lot the relation. And so we will get these optimized coefficients. And this also implied the classical Runge-Kutta-Nystrom condition, which is this. Okay. But by using this this relation here, we can have even better coefficients. Okay. Okay, so now I will try to explain a little more about this. Okay. So we write at the beginning. We write so these different steps. So we correspond to do advection in X, advection in V, and so on. So this is just a product of exponential, and then we use so the classical Becker-Campbell-Hausdorff formula, and so we can re-put it as in this way. So, in fact, because the general is there is no commutation, okay? If it's constant advection in each direction, of course, everything commutes. But in general, there is no commutation. And what appears is just this different bracket, okay? So you can do this. Generally, this is done for matrix. It's well known, but this also works. The same algebra works for this. It's just algebraic, okay? And so what we can compute, so we can compute this polynomial. We have some polynomials in AI and BI. And so this is a very complicated formula. And so it's nonlinear, but then you can choose. So the order conditions will be to that these coefficients are zero, in fact, so that we have high order method. And so so this is the classical way. But then we can use, we call this modified potential, is that we can, instead of using just TU, we can add the modified potential, TUU, which is here only 2U. And so we can get so even better simplification. Okay, so we will have less exponential in this way. Okay. And so... that's why, so you see the coefficients that you had before depend also on delta t. Okay, this is because we have this further simplification. Okay. Of course, you have to have a code also that takes that computes the coefficients, which because it's non-linear in the coefficients. But these people who do splitting, they know this good and they can provide so these coefficients. So this finish the theoretical part. So we will now move to the numerical part. So that is numerical results, what we obtain for the different cases. Okay. So first, one thing that is important is to look at the L2 norm. The L2 norm doesn't give the error, but it's a lower bound of the L2 of the L2 error. Okay, so this that means that the error is at least this. Okay, so some scheme have the L2 norm exact, but it does not mean that there are no error. Okay, but this gives an indication. Okay. And in particular, when the schemes are does not preserve the L2 norm, sometimes it's a good measure of the error. Okay, so what do we see? So here we look at the small drive case. Okay, so this is with a very tiny amplitude. Okay, and so T drive is equal to 200. And so what we see, so here there is a comparison between uniform code and non-uniform code. Okay, and what we see, So here is the example when we use 16,000 points in V. So okay, and this has a similar behavior that if you used NV equal this 262,000 points in V. Okay, so we get the same results on the L2 norm. Okay, so it's really useful here to use non-uniform cubic splines. Okay. And then, so in this picture, we see a lot of how the numerical schemes behave. Okay. So next, there is one case that we had a really problem is, in fact, it was not the small drive case. In fact, the small drive case was not so problematic for our study. The canonical case, in fact, that was studied long above. In fact, we had always some shift in the phase space, and so you have seen in the numerical results with GPU, there was always this shift. This can occur, but at time 1000, we have reduced, so no the error, and so this a priori doesn't know more occur. And this we have really seen by looking at the L2 norm. In fact, you see, so there is the problem of the filamentation, and what we see is that if we increase the number of before we did increase just the point in V. But in fact, we have also to, that's naive, but we have also to increase the point in X to have better results. And so we didn't thought that we have to take so many points to in X, so we had a blockage, to psychological blockage to do it, maybe. And but then if we improve also the number of points in X, in fact, in each curve, we just improve the number of X and the number of points in V. And then we see that we really gain the results about the L2 norm, so better L2 norm conservation. So it's strict. And what is the result? So the first result was the pink curve is the result that is obtained with the classical parameter, that is 500 points in X and 4,000 points in X, strong splitting. And so you see that you really improve a lot by using more points and more better method. Okay. So then this just explains that if we fix the resolution in X, to be a certain value, so here 2000, then we can no more, we are converged in V, in fact. We have enough points in V, and even if we improve the number of points in V in non-uniform, we see that this doesn't help. We have to really to take more points in X. Okay. Also, what we saw before is when we change the delta t. So this is more complicated. Okay, what is generally thought is that when the delta t is the smallest possible, then we make the smaller error. But this doesn't work for semi Lagrangian scheme. It's not true because there is sometimes more interpolation error. So it depends on the order of the scheme. When we use higher order in time, I think it's not good. We have to take the delta t small enough that the error in time is smaller than the error in space, but then we have not to go to finer and finer mesh. I think it's not the good way. Okay, so then here we compare with uniform. Okay, so we see that with non-uniform we are better than with uniform. So this is for the big drive case, canonical drive case. So we gain also. We gain not so much, of course, because the region is bigger. And then, so one more complicated feature is how it behaves, so with the time step, okay? So if we use more time steps, okay, delta t smaller, so you get, a priori, more L2-norm errors, okay? Because you do more interpolation, so you degrade the L2-norm. This does not mean that you make less error. It's just the L2-norm, okay? So we see this. So it can be very different, but not so different as when you just double the number of points in X and V. So this is for a strong splitting. And you see this, that for the sixth order, you have less error for the L2 norm because you use a bigger time step, and so it's also a favor to use a higher order method because you can use a bigger time step. Okay. And then we have also repeated this, but for the sixth order scheme. Okay, so we have repeated, and we use time steps smaller and smaller. Okay, but what is strange? What we have remarked is that okay, the L2 norms decrease, but then it can even increase when we take delta t. So this is not. In fact, at the limit, maybe the L2 norm can be exact, in fact. So this, and that doesn't mean that we make no error, but this we go to the semi-discrete scheme that is not only discretization in the phase space. Okay? So that means the error in L2 norm can is not always decreased. So one way to study this was to use the L2 norm, but this doesn't give the error. Okay, one thing would be to check for the error by looking at a refined solution. Okay, so this we have not done for the moment, but the problem also is to see what is the refined solution. So it's not so easy. And so what we have done for the moment is to look at the rho harmonics and to see how well they behave, the rho harmonics, okay? If they match at the high norm, if they well match. Okay, so what we have remarked is that when we take, so this also on the L2 norm, so for the small drive case, so if we take this number of points, it is comparable to the other number of points in the case of non-uniform cubic splines. And so the delta t for strong is really smaller here than the delta t for six order. Okay, so the delta t for six order, it's enough to take this number of points, this delta t to have the same results are this really small delta t for strong. Okay, so and this so small delta t for strings, this means a lot of iteration. Okay, so so it's really good to use this six-order scheme. And also, what we hear, this is for convergence among the same method. Okay, so we see that until the time 1000, we have almost the same result with this number of points. Okay. And this can be checked so on the row harmonics. Okay, this is this big picture, but it's the same as this, but it's qualitative results of this. So it's each time the schemes are compared, okay, to see how well they behave. Okay, so we can do the same for the canonical drive. Okay, so for the canonical drive, the results are not so impressive, but still, we gain. Okay, so we have to take much more points. So this is for the convergence of the row harmonics. Okay, so this is also a thing. Do we want really to have the convergence? So because at a given time, okay, we can have, but for a very long time, we cannot. Okay, because we have. Okay, so we have just made the study here. We fix at a given time, and we see the convergence. But then we will see also plots what happens when we go to higher order, and we will see in fact that the convergence is not. Sometimes you can have a good measure of some things, but without having the convergence. So we will see this later. So this is So this is the same thing, but for the canonical drive. Okay, so so like Bedros said, so now we have shown the horse to go to the city, and now we will show the city. So the city is the physics. But I'm not a physicist. But so Bedros really insisted to put a lot of diagnostics, so we don't understand. And so we just have added one. So this is the RMS quantity. So it's the Fourier mode in K and average in velocity in L2. Okay. And also, of course, the delta F distribution function. In fact, when you show the delta F distribution function, I think this is the best because all the information is inside. Then, but it's also good to have some RMS quantity. But I think really progress has been made each time we showed the distribution function, which is not always so easy because there are so many points. So it takes time to generate this delta F distribution function. Okay. So now we will make a study by looking at the weak drive case. Okay, this was the aim. And we will change the duration drive. Okay, so we will see what happens if we take a duration time 100, 150, and 200. So we'll see that for 200, we will really get these skin waves. Not so good as a canonical case, but we will see these skin waves. For 100, we will see that this doesn't appear. Even for a long time, it begins to have something, but it doesn't appear. And for 150, it appears maybe some kin waves, but there is still some vorticlets around him. So there is three vorticlets that stays for a long time. Okay. So we will see this. Okay. So and this, in fact, can be linked, in fact, to this diagnostic that Bedros really insisted to add. But this is just one diagnostic. Of course, he wants a lot more diagnostics. So you can see really that the curves are different, and you see that in fact you can see. So it's also for time 50. So you can see that here. So here you are really a kin wave. So that you and here it's not really kin waves. Okay. So you see it here on this picture. You can see this. And so here we have done. So here we go really further in time. Okay, so it's not for the small drive case. So the convergence study was down to 5,000, but here we go to 40,000. Okay, so really we have no more time conversion. But we still look at different runs with different resolution, and we see that the results are quite the same, even if we have but if we look in detail, you will see there can be some shifts and so. But this, it doesn't care for the physicists, it doesn't care. So now I understand maybe more what he said about this convergence. Okay. And so here it's the same. So here the delta t is changed. So we have just changed the delta t. And here we change the convergence, so the number of points in x and v, so with the same delta t. And we observe the same behavior. Okay. And so here we can go even further because we use less points. Okay. So every run was limited to 1 day. Okay. So we have not done more because otherwise we have to restart, and so it's more complicated. And so we see this, and now we will see so this behavior, but also on the distribution function. So here is the distribution function at time 5000 for the small drive cane, and T drive equals 100. So you see really this filamentation, it's just this begin of so Lando, like the strong Lando lamping is a little the same. So it's really, so you see that you have to take a lot of points in V, in this plot. Okay. And then you see, so this is really late in time. So really late in time you observe this. So I have put in a different picture so that we can see, because it's only a small region. So you see, maybe this is the beginning of a kin wave, but it's a very long time in time, and you have no more convergence. But maybe there is something, but it's not a real kin wave that is formed at the beginning. Okay. And this is the last part. Okay. And now this is 300 equal 150. So you see there is not so fine in V, but it appears something. So this is at time 5000. And then you see late in time, you see some kin waves maybe, but there is still some other. So it's not a real kin wave. Okay, and then you see for times 200, so you see at time 5000 where we are really convergence, you see that the kin wave is beginning to form. Okay, and then at the really late time, so this kin wave stays. So this stays. Okay. Okay, so that's finished. And here you see the canonical case where you have really this big. And so it's a better result than the previous on the GPU case. Okay, so you see this real kin wave that will stay along and along, but then there it will be diffused. And so, okay. Okay, so that's finished the study. So in conclusion, so we have done some numerical simulation of kin waves. And so we see the different behavior between some tiny vortices which cannot really get big kin waves, and so we see a little the transition. And okay, so what's next to do? Maybe we can do a 4D simulation to see the same thing. But the problem of the 4D is to see a real 4D and not just a 2D. If it's only 2D effect, so maybe it's difficult to do. And also, so this is a good test, so we can compare with this continuous Kallerkin to four other methods. And of course, we can improve the performance. And one thing also would be nice to see how to choose the numerical parameters, because there is this delta t. So we have no more, maybe more experience, but still, if we would I don't know if you can do it really automatic. And also, there is this problem of what do we want? Do we want convergence, or do we want to have right long-term average quantity? So, and how to prove this mathematically? I don't know. So, thank you for your attention.